greet you in the wonderful name of the Lord Jesus. It is a privilege for us to be back here. And so we praise the Lord also for all of you that are here. We can open our Bibles in Acts chapter 23. Acts chapter 23. And let's pray together. Lord, we thank you for this tremendous opportunity to come together before you with an expectation, Lord, to receive from you that which is needful for the body, that we might grow thereby into your image and bring you glory. Father, we have nothing to give but that which comes from you, that bread of heaven. Lord, that's all we're looking for. We've realized that this world has very much a snare unto us. But Lord, your way is the way of life. And we do pray that you would continue to minister to us, therefore, your great mercy, so that we might see your Son, truly see him. Pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. So Paul now being taken captive by the Romans, is brought before a council of both the Jews and the Romans as well, there being his captors. And we see a very interesting event that has within it some deep consequences. So let's read it together there from verse 1. And Paul, earnestly beholding the council, said, "Men and brethren, I have lived in all good conscience before God until this day." And the high priest Ananias commanded them that stood by him to smite him on the mouth. Then said Paul unto him, "God shall smite thee, thou whited wall, for sittest thou to judge me after the law, and commandest me to be smitten contrary to the law?" Then they stood by, that stood by, "Revilest thou the high priest?" Then said Paul, "I wist not, brethren, that he was the high priest, for it's written, thou shalt not speak evil of the ruler of thy people." And when Paul perceived that one part were Sadducees and the other part Pharisees, he cried out in the council, "Men and brethren, I am a Pharisee, the son of a Pharisee, of the hope and resurrection of the dead, I am called in question." And when he had so said, there arose a dissension between the Pharisees and the Sadducees, and the multitude was divided. For the Sadducees say that there is no resurrection, neither angel nor spirit, but the Sadducees confessed both. Sorry, the Pharisees. And there arose a great cry, and the scribes that were of the Pharisees' part arose and strove, saying, "We find no evil in this man, but if a spirit or an angel hath spoken to him, let us not fight against God." And when there arose a great dissension the chief captain, fearing lest Paul should have been pulled in pieces of them, commanded the soldiers to go down and to take him by force from among them and bring him unto the castle. Let's read until there. In a great way, there is a testimony here to be seen of the way that the Lord deals with us as His disciples. You know, there has often been this thing amongst Christians that God will not allow difficult things to come upon them, kind of having this hope that they would escape tribulation. And yet, when we see this happening to Paul, it's clear that that's not true. He is taken captive and he is being mistreated, falsely accused, and he has no real freedom at this point in his life. He must do everything and go everywhere that these soldiers and these people bid him. Now, we know that he is free, but it's a different type of freedom. It's not a freedom of motion, it's not a freedom of doing what you want, it's the freedom of doing God's will. Caring not for the cost, caring not for the price it may cost him, he is free to do God's will completely. And that is the freedom which Jesus came to give us. A freedom where we need not fear anything, but step in line to what the Father says to us and what the Father gives us. Now, we stopped reading our passage this morning, the line or the verse before Jesus encourages him in the night. And we should have read it. Some of you may have read it. But it is a confirmation that Paul was 100% in step with God. He was 100% in step with God unto this very point, which in itself is a real confrontation to every one of us. Why do we keep on taking steps to avoid suffering? Why do we do that? Why would do we choose to rather please our flesh, to seek the favor of men, to seek earthly joys? Why do we do that? If we realize that staying in the Father's will is life, it is where there is abundance, it is where we will hear His voice. It is where He will feast with us. And so Paul, earnestly beholding the council, said, "Men and brethren, I have lived in all good conscience before God until this day." To have a conscience void of offense. There's a verse I want to quickly go to. First Timothy 1 verse 19. holding faith and a good conscience, which some having put away concerning faith have made shipwreck. Have made shipwreck. Good conscience. What is a good conscience? A good conscience, that the one of the ways to test, and I know it's quite, because of a conscience being seared, you know, you can sear your conscience. There's a passage First Timothy chapter 4 verse 2. Speaking lies and hypocrisy, having their conscience seared with a hot iron. There is a searing of the conscience. Now searing, for those who are not farmers, is when you put something in a fire, make it very hot, and then you burn. You sear something. So there is a suffering there. It's a painful process, but it ends, oftentimes sort of seals a wound or closes up a wound. So it's a way of stopping bleeding and basically sanitizing something. So the conscience, therefore, is a place that gets hurt because of your sin. So you get hurt and it's bleeding and you don't know how to live with yourself. It's a sort of a, you've made, done a wrong thing and now you don't know how to deal with it. You don't know what to do. It's, you know you did wrong. You know you should have repent now. You know you should flee, but you're stuck. So you take a hot iron and you kill that feeling. You kill it. You burn it dead so you can't feel it. So that you can live with yourself and not make right. That is to searing the conscience. It's a very awful thing because it leads you into further being unaware how far you are drifting into very great danger. So you could think of it this way. You're seeing maybe something, you're seeing a great danger and you're frightened. And then you gouge out your eyes so that you won't see the danger and so you're relaxed. It's that kind of solution. The fact that you can't see the danger anymore doesn't take it away. But you think it does. But it doesn't. That threat of imminent destruction is still there. And one of the ways that you can, I have seen at least in my life, that can be sort of shaken up, is when your life is suddenly threatened. So let's say you're quite at peace, you know, you don't think there's anything wrong, and then suddenly your life is threatened and you would do everything to save yourself. You're afraid of dying. Now, I'm not talking to people who are never been believers of God's word. I'm talking to people who has believed God's word and have fallen away. Because yes, there are people who have so twisted their consciences that they are not even afraid of death, you know, though they are in great error. But those who are actually believers of God's word, who has backslided and who has forsaken the testimony of the Holy Spirit in their lives and have resisted Him, you put them suddenly in danger of losing their life. Or at least of great harm, you will see that you don't have peace with God. You will be afraid. Because suddenly all the acting will no more help, it won't help you. You will know. Because the truth is the truth. You can't get away from it. Though you sear your conscience, you are in danger because of the way you have lied and you have stayed in hypocrisy. Speaking lies in hypocrisy, having their conscience seared. That's very serious and it's very dangerous. Like we said, it's like seeing a huge snake, knowing it's intensely poisonous and it's coming right at you. Instead of fleeing to the Lord, you gouge your eyes out and just relax. It's absolutely madness. Now Paul says to these people, he's lived in a good conscience. A good conscience. Armed with a good conscience. You know, 1 Peter 3:16, having a good conscience, that whereas they speak evil of you as evildoers, they may be ashamed that falsely accuse your good conversation in Christ. A good conscience. A clear conscience. Holding the mystery of faith in a pure conscience. Having a pure conscience with faith is critical. Don't tell me I have faith, but you know you have been playing God a fool. That's not a good conscience. That's not a pure conscience. You can't say, I have faith in Jesus. And keep on doing things that defile your conscience. That is not Christian life. That is hypocrisy. And it's not pure conscience. Hebrews 9:14. How much more shall the blood of Christ, whom through the eternal Spirit offered himself without spot to God, purge your conscience from dead works to serve the living God? There is a way to have the conscience fixed. There is a way to be fixed. You see, so if we read there in Hebrews 10, verse 2, the law having a shadow, verse 1, of good things to come, not the very image of the things, can never with those sacrifices which they offered year by year continually make the comers thereof perfect. So, first, we are talking here about the Old Testament sacrificial system, the Levitical priesthood. This is saying it couldn't make the comers perfect. That was one of the main reasons why it was replaced with the new covenant. So, why? Because it could not make the comers thereof perfect. So what does the New Testament covenant then do? For then would they not have ceased to be offered? It's the question. because that the worshippers once purged should have no more conscience of sin. If that old covenant worked, it meant that you would bring your sacrifice and no longer feel guilty. But you still felt guilty. But in those sacrifices, there is a remembrance again made of sin every year. If it's not possible that the blood of bulls and of goats should take away sin. For when he cometh into the world, he says, sacrifice and offering thou wouldst not, but a body hast thou prepared me. In burnt offerings and sacrifices for sins thou hast had no pleasure. Then said I, lo, I come. In the volume of the book it's written of me, to do thy will, O God. Above, when he says, sacrifice and offerings and burnt offerings, offerings for sin thou wouldest not, neither hast pleasure therein, which is offered by the law. Then said I, lo, I come to do thy will, O God. He taketh away the first, that he may establish the second. By the which will we are sanctified through the offering of the blood of Jesus Christ once for all. The body. The body of Jesus Christ once for all. And every priest standeth daily ministering, offering oftentimes the same sacrifices, which can never take away sin. But this man, after he had offered one sacrifice for sin forever, sat down on the right hand of God, from whence expecting till his enemies be made his footstool. For by one offering he hath perfected, he hath perfected forever them that are sanctified. What does that sanctified mean? Conscience void of offense. Conscience void of offense. He has sanctified. That is to take and clean and set aside and keep clean. Now, how do you keep something clean? It's quite obvious. It's quite obvious. But somehow people don't think about it. I don't know. You wash it. And if it's dirty, you wash it again. And if it's dirty, you wash it again. And you don't get upset when it's dirty, you just wash it again. It's just how you keep it clean. Jesus said, unless I wash your feet, and that's a daily thing, you have no part in me. And that washing is not the same as the searing. What does the searing do? So that you can see the difference. There is a very big difference between the searing and the washing. But they outwardly look the same. And that is that you are not feeling guilty. So both make you not feel guilty. But there is one way to know the difference very clearly. And I think the best to explain or demonstrate is to use an example. So, let's say you used to struggle with drunkenness. You used to be drinking and get drunk, go to parties. Now you become a Christian. And you believe the Lord Jesus and you see the sanctifying grace of God. You believe on the blood. You believe. And there is this joy that God has come to save you from your sin. And then, some days later, it happens that you get tricked into being at some place where you shouldn't have been. And before you know it, you take another sip. And before you know it, you're given to the flesh. Now, at this point, we are making a fork. One will sear his conscience. The other will be cleansed of his sin. The one who sears his conscience will feel at first very guilty about what he did, and he would try to hide it. Maybe he would even try to tell someone. But in that struggle, he kills that guilt without repentance, without a decision never to do it again. So he no longer feels guilty because he's just human. And everybody is like this, so why are they judging me? I am just like them, and they, who are they to point a finger? And he sears his conscience so that he no longer feels guilty. He can still go to church, he could still sit in the row, and he can think himself void of offense. He thinks his conscience is clear because he no longer feels bad about what he's done. But he does it again. And again. And he keeps on doing it, thinking, I'm forgiven. I am fine. Now, that's the one that is seared, his conscience. The other one, who went to get his feet washed, he realizes he has sinned. He realizes that Jesus told him that if any man have sinned, he should come to him. So he runs to the Lord. He's broken before God. He's desperate. He feels helpless. He feels like he's losing everything. And in that struggle, he sees the nail-pierced hands of the Lord, and he realizes the Lord has bled for him, and that the blood indeed has washed away his sin. And he finds the Father smiling, and he finds a welcoming. It's almost like, you know, he's almost uncertain about, is God really not upset? He sits there washing his feet as a servant and treating him like so special, while he knows he's the dirt of the earth. And then he goes out with a clear conscience and sensitive not to do it again. And so when he again hears those friends calling, he gets a pain. He's like, no. And he doesn't go there. He avoids it because he loves the Lord. He finds forgiveness, he finds sanctification, and so he grows into the Lord's image. He doesn't stay there. Now that's a sort of a crude example, and I could have used anything, but that's what came up first. So Paul says he's void. His conscience is clean, good. That means he has not done anything about which he feels guilty. Listen, you might live in a Christianity which tells you that is not possible, but that's a lie. The Christianity of the Bible tells us that is possible, and it's not even necessary to be a Christian. Because Paul was speaking about his whole life, including the time before he became Christian. So even as a Pharisee, he did not do things which grieved God of which made his conscience accuse him before God. Now the conscience is not the Holy Spirit. It is the bottom millstone, whereas the Holy Spirit is the upper millstone, and we are the grain. That's one way that some have sort of tried to explain the law of God in you and the Spirit of God as the law of God above you, sanctifying you. So, it's very important that the conscience be trained. Some people's conscience are weak, and so they think everything in life is sin. If you drink coffee, you're in sin. If you eat sugar, you're in sin. They have all these things that they think is sin, which isn't sin in itself. And it's because of a weak conscience. They've believed scientists who don't even fear God. For some reason, they have been impressed by the wisdom of men, which the Bible calls will worship, which seems to have wisdom in it, because it has a sort of discipline on the body. But it is the worship of angels. It has no value truly to the spiritual walk. For only what the Holy Spirit says is sin, that is sin. And so, there is a place where we see the teachings about not eating meat and not going to the idol's temple, things that were spoken of in the New Testament. We see how Paul, by the Holy Spirit, was led to teach the conscience that eating meat offered to idols is nothing. So today, we Christians, we go, we buy things in the shop, and even if it's have a you know, these butter and jam and all these things we buy from the shop, even if it has a halal on it, we don't care. Why? Because it's not that goes into the body that defiles it, but what comes out of the heart. Have we forgotten the teachings of our Lord? Or we become so deceived, having believed lies, that our conscience has trapped us into a Christianity without joy, self-righteousness, judging everybody who breathes in a way they shouldn't have. Where's your mask? So we find a very serious problem. The enemy plays both sides of the fence. He not only sears the conscience, but he overempowers it. And it's only by the truth of God's word, that the conscience can be set right. And it requires you to be willing to be ridiculed by your peers. It requires you to stand firm against the stream. It requires you to probably stand alone. Or everybody says, this is sinful. Drinking a glass of soda, Coke, it's sinful. You say, no. It's not. Give me one, please. Why? Not because you want to bring your brother to stumble, but you want to help people face the real sin in their lives. You know, I've seen people so busy with these things, they never get to denying self. They think they're busy with it because, I mean, they really would like some Coke. You know, they can't have any, so now they are very... And I'm thinking, what? If it wasn't for the grace of the Lord that took me into the desert as a young believer and had me fasted many days with only water, I probably would have made the same mistake. But I saw very clearly the tremendous power of the Spirit in self-control. I saw that he could put away food and everything the body needs just like that if he knows this is the Father's will. If we know as Christians the Father doesn't want us to do something, we can immediately walk away from it. And so I saw how the Lord could just restrain my whole body, my life, my everything for 21 days, 7 days, 3 days, any time of how many days he wanted. Just like that. And I realized the problem in my life is not staying away from food. The problem in my life is not drinking Coke or coffee. It's loving my enemies. It's not being jealous, not being envious, being kind, not being in lust of the flesh for being unhappy with what God has given me, being discontent, seeking after riches. You know, the things the Bible actually specifically talks about. Those are the things we should guard against. And so the enemy, he's playing both sides of the fence. Not only is he dragging you into an overly complicated conscience, he also drags you into no conscience at all. And then he even mixes it. So I've met people, they believe in the Bible very firmly and have a whole lot of things overly complicated, but then they think there's nothing wrong with drinking. They have their parties. You can't believe it. And so I have seen the enemy play this any way he likes. It is really not a game. And if you realize how serious this matter is, then what are you doing? How would you know the truth? What would you do to judge yourself? How would you judge yourself? How would you know whether your conscience is seared or whether you have been cleansed? By this you will know that you love him, that you keep his commandments. And his commandments are not burdensome. By this you shall know. There are more verses, but in simplicity, if you keep my words, my Father and I will come and make our abode with you. There is a place where we love the truth, and therefore the truth lives with us. Loving the truth will inevitably confront the self-life and expose it. For God is the one who exposes all these deceptions. If you would let him be your everlasting light, will you let him search you? Would you let him shine his strong light, that eternal light, in your life, in your heart? Would you let him? So, what must he do? If their conscience have been seared, what needs to happen? So if you think about, you know, that branding iron, you seared the conscience, it makes a sort of a scale there. He must take a knife, and he must cut it off and open that wound. And suddenly all that pain crashes back into your life. And suddenly you feel like there's no hope for you. But that's what's necessary. That serious realization of the guilt because of your sin will drive you to Christ, who truly washes and cleanses his people. And so, what does that mean? If you still think about your sin as, ah, it's just, you know, it means nothing's happened. If you can still just go back to your sin and, you know, come to church and sit down, nothing's happened. Because God needs to open that seared conscience. He needs to bring it back to life, and that will bring you to your knees. You will not know how to look people in the eyes. You will be crushed. You will be broken. That is what needs to happen. You need to see the sin again for what it really is. You need your eyes back and see that snake. You need to scream and holler and say, I'm gonna perish! That's what needs to happen. You need to wake up! Not because you're saved by works, but because the blood of Jesus cleanses, not some hot iron that sears the conscience. And Ananias the high priest commanded them that stood by to smite him on the mouth. Why would he do that? Because the old covenant couldn't take away the guilt. And him being the high priest, he felt guilty. How, who does this guy think he is, saying that he has clear conscience? Smack him! He's definitely a liar. So what happens to men who are religious but not washed? They can't believe that others can be clean. They always think others are just hiding it better. They always think that others are just acting it better. And why are you judging me? Who are you? Look, you have also got faults. And they're always very good at finding a reason to smack you. Sorry. They find a reason to give you a smack. Now, was Paul at fault? Yes. You know, Paul said, God smite thee, thou whited wall. What? That's quite shocking. If it wasn't the high priest, then that which Paul says there will stand. So unless you're the high priest, you're in danger. If you want to smite a child of God who says he's clean, and you think, oh, who are you? Smite him. You're in danger. Whited wall. That's what the Bible is like. Whoa. God shall smite you. Thou whited wall. For thou judgest me after the law and commandest me to be smitten contrary to the law. And they that stood by said, revilest thou God's high priest? And Paul said, I wist not, brethren, that he was the high priest. For it's written, thou shalt not speak evil of the ruler of thy people. And that was the end of it. Back to the battle at hand. And I always think about this. It wasn't like a long debate about how wrong the high priest is. It was just, ooh, sorry, I shouldn't have said that. And back to the gospel, back to the message. Oh, he always blesses my soul. That though Ananias was wrong, Paul believed firmly that he should not speak right, you know, evil against him. What kind of faith is that? What kind of faith is that? You know, there is something very awful happening in the earth right now, and it's a trap, people. It's a trap. There is this great movement against another movement. I don't want to name names. The one is called something great, and the other one is also called something great. And it's contrary to each other. It's almost like the Pharisees and the Sadducees. The one is sad and the other one is fair. So it's a very fair Sadducee. And they are at each other's throat. And the Christians are taking sides. But both are godless. And both are breaking everything of what our Lord told us to do about honoring our leaders, about respecting the government. Because they want to break the bands that God has put upon them. Psalms 2. They want to break free from the authorities and the authoritative structure that God put in place. They want a new authority, which the Bible says is a beast of iron teeth that destroys everything in its path. And I've always wondered about how can that be? Because when I look into the world, I see a worldly system rising up that is revolutionary, that brings peace and prosperity, that sets people at ease, that gives sin like cheese that is such a breeze. And I wonder, but where is this animal of teeth that's going to just step on everything and crush it? And then it was like, of course, it's not talking about us. It's talking about everything of God. Everything of truth. Everything of what's holy. Everything of what's pure. This beast is devouring it and crushing it and ruining it. And yes, and that we do see. It is doing that. Its champions are the greatest harlots of the earth. It is a very frightening thing coming upon the earth. And I tell you, Christians, don't pick a side. Stay with the Lord. They are both wrong. The idea that one is right is absolutely folly. Yes, but we can't just do nothing. Oh, so you're saying me sitting in the very throne of God speaking to the Creator is nothing. You got another thing coming. That is not nothing. You might not believe that someone can sit in God's throne and speak to Him. You may not believe that someone can have such freedom. But that's the very gospel. And so you're not Christian if you don't believe that. You're not really born again, because if you don't see the truth of the resurrected life given unto the believers called the Holy Spirit, then you have no idea what you're in, what you're involved in. No, you're just in dead religion. That's all you have. For where the Spirit of God is, there is liberty. Where the Spirit of God is, there is no more fear. Where the Spirit of God is, there is authority against sin. We don't need to act. We don't need to pretend. He will really cleanse you. He will really repair what the locusts have eaten. And when Paul was now being smitten for saying that he was living a life void of offense, a life where he doesn't feel guilty before God until this day, someone who was supposed to be the most spiritual among them had them smite him. Bah! Now I'm sure that did upset Paul a bit. And I can't say for certain if he should have said anything. But one thing is sure, he is right that if you can't believe that Jesus came in the flesh, you are in the arms of deceivers. Because believing that Jesus came in the flesh means that you believe you can follow him. And Jesus did not pretend. He didn't act. So now from here to verse 10. Then said Paul, I wish not, brethren, that he was the high priest, for it's written, thou shalt not speak evil of the ruler of thy people. It's written. But when Paul perceived that one part were Sadducees and the other Pharisees. So he perceived what they are fighting about. And he chose a side. I know I just said shouldn't choose a side. But he chose a side. And so, in a way, I have also seen us take a side. But now I ask you, the side he chose, did he really choose that side? Or was it just the most obvious right of the two? Now we know that Jesus spoke to the Pharisees and Sadducees while he was here, right? And he also corrected who? He corrected the Sadducees. He also said that you are in error. To whom? The Sadducees. He said to them, you don't believe the scripture nor the power of God. For Abraham, God is the God of Abraham, Isaac, and of Jacob. He's not the God of the dead, but of the living. And by that, proving to the Sadducees that they are in error. And so, Paul, knowing that the Sadducees are in error, chose the side of the Pharisees in this meeting here. But there's another reason. The Pharisees held to two or three things here, which we can see here. The hope and resurrection of the dead. That's the one. Hope and resurrection of the dead. And the reason why I said earlier, don't choose a side, is because both sides today do not believe this. The pro-vaxxers and the anti-vaxxers, okay? The enemy has really twisted the world. That the two choices that are out there today are both very dangerous. It's best for us to stay out of it. To hide. And to do all those things which doesn't offend our conscience. If we can do something which they ask of us and it doesn't offend our conscience, we do it. But those things we can't do, we just don't do it. But the Pharisees held the hope of resurrection of the dead. And they also held the hope of that there is such a thing as angels and, you know, other beings than us, which we also believe. And it's upon those points which Paul associated himself. And so he sort of did it in a way that I think we can learn from. He didn't say, I agree with all the Pharisees said. Now, he picked up that one thing on which he agreed. The resurrection of the dead, am I called in question? That one thing. The resurrection. And so, God gave him wisdom. And what also surprises me is how the Pharisees suddenly took him as one of their own and defended him. The Pharisees, they eventually said, we find no evil in this man. But if a spirit or an angel spoke unto him, let us not fight against God. So they took him as one of their own, just because he associated with them. Did that save them? No, of course not. But they were now suddenly friends of Paul. That's why I say this passage has tremendous... There's something very difficult here, actually. Something of a... I thought we should not choose sides. And what is he doing here? And I see a wisdom. Men, brethren, he that does not work should not eat. Nobody has the right to take away our right to work. The reason why I am under persecution today is because of the hope of working. And earning a living. Brothers, must I be more clear? There is a way for us to speak about things without speaking and joining the fight as such. Let them fight. Where are we on, as Paul now, what was he busy doing? He was doing what the Spirit gave him to do. We know that this resulted in him not being killed. And had he not done this, he would probably have been killed. Why? Because God wanted him to go to Rome, and that's what we see here in verse 11. The night following, the Lord stood by him and said, be of good cheer, Paul, for as thou hast testified of me in Jerusalem, so must thou be a witness also at Rome. Bam. So, what is one of the next challenges we see as a Christian? We see Paul teaching against the love of the world. We see Paul teaching against not honoring leadership. Then he stands before this group and he calls the high priest a whitewashed wall, which is contrary to his own teaching. And someone says, hey, that's the high priest. He says, oh, I'm sorry. That's what happens. I've seen it in my own life. I've seen it in other brothers' lives. They have firm convictions. They stand firm on their beliefs. And then they do something which is wrong. But they didn't know it. What are you going to do now? Are you going to change the rules? Yeah, but
But he's going contrary to the law.
What are you going to do? What did Paul have to do so that he can be testifying of God? What did he have to do? I am wrong. I'm sorry. Then he'd been teaching very sternly and very firmly that you shouldn't seek the favor of men. We know that. You go read the epistles. This is not assumption. Paul is teaching it quite sternly and firmly that you should not entangle yourself with what? The affairs of this life. That you may please him that has enrolled you as a soldier. He's teaching this. This is at the end of his ministry. Now, suddenly, he joins the Pharisees. Hey, I'm one of you. But that looks so contrary to what Paul is teaching. But he is not joining the Pharisees. He's exposing their own hypocrisy. He's using their own inconsistencies. He is really playing them against each other. That's what he did. He played them against each other. He didn't get into it. He's like, okay, yeah, listen, I'm actually one of you. Boom, they fight. And over what? Over him. He's not fighting. What you mean, brother? It's about knowing the culture. Knowing the people you are reaching out to. Knowing what they believe, knowing their arguments, knowing their positions, knowing their internal wars. And seeing which one of them is at what point has a point and is in agreement with truth and starting to use that to benefit the gospel. But how would we know? How would we know? Because in the moment, the Lord leads us by His Spirit. That's how we would know. So there is a lot of information which Paul had to learn because of prior experiences and things. So much that he didn't know what he'll do when getting into such a situation. He didn't have any idea. But the Lord had him gather all the necessary information so that at that moment the Spirit could just take it and use it. And this is what we need to do. We need to know the people enough that we can help them by helping them see their own inconsistencies. And what I have seen that is so heartbreaking is that they are more able to see our inconsistencies than we are able to see theirs. The world is more aware of the hypocrisy in the church than the church is aware of it. And that means we haven't started judging ourselves. We haven't started looking at passages like these and letting the Lord shine light through it so that He'll expose us, so that we will see our own misgivings. Judgment must begin at the house of God. It's only when you have allowed God to judge you that you will find true, lasting peace. Victory. Love. I have seen people who struggle to forgive others. And the only reason is because they are so unsure that God really forgave them. They won't admit it. You know, if you press them, they're like, no, he's forgiven me. But they keep everybody else on a short leash. Pay my $20, pay it. Make sure that they get their money. They don't have mercy and grace. Oh no, because if I don't deal with him harshly, he'll just keep on doing it. Oh really? So it was God dealing harshly with you that helped you, huh? It was the wrath and the terror of God that drove you to the cross, right? Or was it his love? Was the fact that you have not perished, that he has shown you mercy, that he has shown you patience, kindness, meekness. The Bible says, the love of God constraineth me. The love of God constraineth me. There is a place where, yes, the law, the judgment, all these things. But when a person has been made, if that conscience is awake again, if that person realizes their guilt again, and they are no longer acting as if there is no problem, it's the balm of Gilead, brothers. It's the balm of Gilead. It is the healing hand of God. It's the only way for them to get right. It's the certainty that the blood is indeed enough, that Jesus truly forgives and really forgets, that his love covers a multitude of sin. And so Paul's life was being threatened because of this great dissension. That the soldiers came and took him. So for who were they all there? The soldiers were there for Paul. The Pharisees were there for him. And the Sadducees. For why? So that they all can get thinking about these things of importance. They all heard this testimony of Paul that God appeared unto him and called himself Jesus. They all heard that, because that's the testimony he gave, remember, before he got taken the first time. He was sharing in the message of his testimony, how he got saved, how God entered his life, how he opened his eyes, the truth about Jesus. And what does Jesus say? Be of good cheer, Paul, for as thou hast testified of me, your testimony is testifying of Jesus. You may be talking about what happened to you. You may be talking about how he opened your eyes. But you are busy testifying of him. Be of good cheer. And so in conclusion, we are thinking for the following message on Wednesday. About from verse 11. A theme which I have seen a number of times repeated in Scripture. A theme that if God has chosen to use you, then he would make a very big deal that it will happen. He will take many things out of the way so that he can use you. He will change the heart of kings. He would move nations. He would do many things so that he can use you. Isn't that such a relief? God will make it happen. And all we need to do is believe him. It's not because of us. It's in spite of us. But he'll do it. Let's close our eyes and pray. Lord, we thank you for encouraging us again this morning. That in all things you are a great conqueror. You have overcome our enemies. You have defeated our foes. You have exposed ourselves to the very deepest core of our heart's deception. And you have rescued us. For you are our Savior. Your word is a burning lamp. A light shining bright, having discernment into the intents and motives and thoughts of the heart, dividing, judging those inner things we think and feel. We pray, Lord, work among us that we will not have seared consciences. Work among us, Lord, that we will be awakened to your Spirit, that we will receive that joy that comes from above, that peace, that reality of your indwelling Spirit. We pray, Lord, this not because we deserve any of this, somewhat better than other people. No, by far. This be not true. We are sinners, saved by the blood of Jesus, given access to the throne of grace, whereto we can flee in times of need, to be helped, to be cleansed, to be washed, to be sanctified, to have our feet washed, that we may have part in you. That we do not need to pretend, that we do not need to sear our conscience and struggle with guilt. We can be helped and washed and cleansed and delivered. We thank you for once again, Lord, encouraging us in this way. We pray that your word will not return to your void, but it will accomplish that which you send it out to do. We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen.